Hey everybody, Marcus here. There are two beliefs that are commonly held by a lot of people in the MGTOW community. In fact, any suggestion that either of these beliefs are false is typically met with some level of skepticism at best and ridicule at worst. Also, these beliefs are usually held to be true at the same time. The first belief has five names commonly used interchangeably. These are ontological naturalism, naturalism, ontological physicalism, physicalism, and materialism. Though some defenders of this position may bicker about differences between physicalism and materialism, we will, well, for the purpose of this video, consider all these names to speak of the same thing. For the remainder of this video, I will use the term naturalism exclusively for the sake of consistency. Now, for those who may not be familiar with naturalism as a philosophical position, I will briefly elaborate. Naturalism is the metaphysical assertion that all that exists is physical, or in other words, all that exists is material. To put it another way, there do not exist any entities which cannot ultimately be reduced to physical qualities. Now, what exactly we mean by physical is beyond the scope of this video. Though it may feel intuitive to object to this metaphysical claim by stating that energy is not itself physical, we must not take a naive definition for the word physical. Indeed, energy and all other articles of modern science are accounted for under the term physical as defended by naturalism. In fact, scientism, namely, the belief that only that which emerges from the natural sciences can be considered articles of knowledge, is nothing more than a reaffirmation of naturalism. After all that exists is physical, and the natural sciences are the best tool for interrogating the physical, then in fact it is obvious that only that which comes from the natural sciences could be considered knowledge. However, let us not distract ourselves with scientism. Naturalism, in asserting that all that exists is physical, necessarily eliminates the possibility that those things typically considered non-physical exist. Things like the soul and God, definitionally, cannot exist in a reality that is composed only of the physical, as both the soul and God are defined as non-physical things. Now, I very seldom encounter people who call themselves atheists who make the strong ontological claim that God does not exist. Of those that do make the strong claim, few ever put forward a positive argument for the lack of existence of God. The assertion is that the burden of proof falls onto the theist to demonstrate the existence of God. Though it is true that the burden of proof falls onto the theist to prove the positive claim that God exists, the absence of such a proof does not entail God does not exist. The burden of proof falls onto the atheist to put forward a positive argument for the absence of the existence of God. If neither side can put forward a positive proof, then one must suspend judgment, as proof would not exist for either position. A common objection of the atheist is to assert that it is not possible to demonstrate the absence of the existence of something. Now, this is false. Here's a simple two-premise naturalistic argument that can be used to such effect. 1. All that exists is physical. 2. God is not physical. 3. Therefore, God does not exist. As most atheists gravitate towards a naturalistic metaphysical position, this simple argument works very well for them and is coherent both with the concepts atheist and their other beliefs. Now, the first premise in the argument, namely, all that exists is physical, is merely the main thesis of naturalism itself. Whether or not this premise is true is a different story, but again, that is not the point of this video. The argument for the non-existence of God that I have put forward is at minimum valid. The force of the argument is contained in the logical impossibility of God under a naturalistic metaphysical position. Now, earlier I said that there were two beliefs that are commonly held in conjunction by many in the MGTOW community. However, I would like to say that these two beliefs are held simultaneously by a great deal of people in general. The first belief, we said, was the metaphysical assertion of naturalism. The second belief is that of evolution. Now, these days, to even suggest evolution is not true is more heretical than to openly call oneself MGTOW. Now, here's where it starts to get interesting. I want to point out something from the very start that you, my listener, need to always keep in mind as you hear the rest of this video. Firstly, naturalism is a metaphysical position independent from the theory of evolution. These two theories can be evaluated in isolation. Whether or not naturalism is true is not dependent on whether or not evolution is true. In the same way, whether or not evolution is true is not dependent on whether or not naturalism is true. And the second thing you need to keep in mind is that this video is in no way interested in asserting whether or not either of these theories are true or false. These are my rules. Now that we have that out of the way, we can move on. The first thing we need to tackle is why most of you are breaking my rules already without even knowing it. But please, let me clarify. When you think of evolution, you are certainly thinking to yourself of the random mutations that are favored through natural or sexual selection. You are thinking of an unguided progression of a biological organism. But here we encounter the problem. Why, when you think of the theory of evolution, you immediately link up the concept of unguided? There's nothing in the theory of evolution that necessitates that the gradual changes that occur in an organism are unguided. In fact, the theory of evolution is completely compatible with the notion that it was guided by some intelligence, such as God. As far as evolution is concerned, either option seems to work just fine. Yet, to suggest a guiding hand in evolution is to immediately associate oneself with the concept of intelligent design, which is probably just as heretical as denying evolution altogether. The question before us becomes this: why do we immediately associate the concept evolution with the concept unguided? We make this association because we have tainted the theory of evolution with naturalism. The theory of evolution has been praised as the theory that overthrew the need for God in the story of the coming to being of various creatures, yet it does no such thing. The theory of evolution is incapable of such a feat on its own. However, when you presuppose naturalism, then indeed only unguided evolution is possible, as naturalism eliminates the possibility of God as a guide. As we demonstrated earlier, under naturalism, God becomes logically impossible, and therefore a being that cannot possibly exist could not possibly have guided anything. Now that we have brought to light this hidden presupposition of naturalism and the common conception of evolution, let us give a more proper name to the sort of evolution that everyone has in mind when they think of evolution. Let us call this unguided form of evolution evolutionary naturalism. In this way, evolutionary naturalism is the combined assertion that both naturalism and evolution are true. The question before us becomes this: is evolutionary naturalism a coherent concept? In other words, can both naturalism and evolution be true at the same time? Now, this is a very different question than asking whether evolution is true or whether naturalism is true. Our new question is interested in determining if indeed you are allowed to believe in both. Let me give you two statements as an example of what I mean. 1. Santa Claus lives at the North Pole. 2. The North Pole does not exist. You see, either of these two statements can be true independently, but they cannot both be true simultaneously. If it is true that Santa Claus lives at the North Pole, then it cannot possibly be true that the North Pole does not exist. Taken the other way, if it is true that the North Pole does not exist, then it cannot possibly be true that Santa Claus lives at the North Pole. The question ahead of us is identical to the Santa Claus example, but the statements are as follows. 1. Naturalism is true. 2. Evolution is true. Are we allowed to coherently believe in both of these things at the same time? Well, let us find out. The argument I'm about to present is from Alvin Plantinga. It is called the Evolutionary Argument Against Naturalism. 1. Our beliefs about the world can only have evolutionary consequences if they affect our behavior. Otherwise, they are invisible to natural selection. 2. Natural selection favors advantageous behaviors, not directly the ability to form true beliefs. 3. Natural selection has no way to favor true, non-adaptive beliefs over false, but adaptive beliefs. 4. Therefore, the probability that our minds consistently deliver true beliefs if both philosophical naturalism and naturalistic evolution are true is low or inscrutable. Now, This is the first part of the argument. What Plantinga is saying is that in unguided evolution, or as we called it, evolutionary naturalism, it is wrong to assume that evolution gives a shit whether or not what we as humans believe is true or false, as long as we behave in a way that is adaptive. As such, if believing in lies leads to more advantageous, more beneficial behaviors for survival, then evolution will favor the mind that believes lies. To put it another way, under evolutionary naturalism, it is completely feasible that what we call logic leads us to behave in ways that are advantageous, but does not lead to truth about the world, as possessing truth is unnecessary as long as we are behaving adaptively. What the conclusion says is that the probability that the human mind could have evolved to be reliable is low to inscrutable. Now, we can move on to the second part of the argument. The first premise in the second argument is the conclusion of the argument we just examined. The second argument goes as follows. 1. The probability that our cognitive faculties are reliable, given evolutionary naturalism, is low. 2. Anyone who believes evolutionary naturalism and sees that 1 is true has a defeater for believing that our cognitive faculties are reliable. 3. Anyone who has a defeater for the belief that his cognitive faculties are reliable has a defeater for any other belief he has. 4. If anyone who believes evolutionary naturalism thereby acquires a defeater for evolutionary naturalism, then evolutionary naturalism is itself self-defeating and cannot be rationally believed. 5. Therefore, evolutionary naturalism cannot be rationally believed. What you may have overlooked is that a defeater needn't show the targeted statement to be false. There are rebutting defeaters and there are undercutting defeaters. A rebutting defeater shows the targeted statement to be false. An undercutting defeater merely removes any warrant for thinking the targeted statement to be true. In Plantinga's argument, it's all about undercutting defeaters. You don't show evolutionary naturalism to be false. You merely show that we can have no warrant for believing in evolutionary naturalism. What this argument, if sound, demonstrates is that it is self-defeating to believe in both naturalism and in evolution. Those two beliefs are simply incompatible. As such, one needs to choose whether or not evolution is true or naturalism is true, but one cannot believe both are true. To many, this will be a vicious circumstance, similar to Sophie's Choice. If you're not familiar with Sophie's Choice, it was a situation in which a killer forced a mother to choose which one of her two children he would murder. If she refused to choose, both would be murdered. Many people are attached to naturalism and evolution as if they were their children, and this argument forces them to choose only one. If they refuse to choose, then indeed, the consequence is they are no longer justified in believing either. Thanks for listening. Go team.